In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My dear friends in Christ, we continue to rejoice in this great season of Christmas, thanking God for the gift of the child Jesus, who comes to us to shower his love upon each one of us. And through the salvation that Jesus brings to the world, we are truly chosen to be his people. And today we join the whole church in celebrating the feast of the Holy Family. The church offers us the Holy Family of Nazareth as an example, as a model for us to follow. Let us today be grateful to God for the gift of our own families. We thank God for the gift of each person in our family, for it is them who have nurtured us. It is them who have brought us up. It is them who has brought us to this point in our lives, that we can truly offer each one of ourselves in the presence of God in our Eucharist this morning. So before we encounter God, especially in his word and in the Eucharist, we acknowledge that we are sinners, sinners in need of God's love. We are in need of God's mercy. Let us pause for a few moments as we acknowledge our failures. We turn to the Lord, not only asking for pardon, but let us also pray that the graces we receive in this Eucharist may truly purify and transform us to be faithful followers of Jesus Christ. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
At the right
Let us pray. O God, who were pleased to give us the shining example of the Holy Family, graciously grant that we may imitate them in practicing the virtues of family life and in the bonds of charity. And so, in the joy of your house, delight one day in eternal rewards. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiasticus. The Lord honors the father in his children and upholds the right of a mother over her sons. Whoever respects his father is atoning for his sins. He who honors his mother is like someone amassing a fortune. Whoever respects his father will be happy with his children of his own. He shall be heard on the day when he prays. Long life comes to him who honors his father. He who sets his mother at ease is showing obedience to the Lord. My son, support your father in his old age. Do not grieve him during his life. Even if his mind should fail, show him sympathy. Do not despise him in your health and strength, for kindness to a father shall not be forgotten, but will serve as a reparation for your sins. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. You are God's chosen race, his saints. He loves you, and you should be clothed in sincere compassion, in kindness and humility, gentleness and patience. Bear with one another, forgive each other, as soon as a quarrel begins. The Lord has forgiven you. Now you must do the same. Over all these clothes, to keep them together and complete them, put on love. And may the peace of Christ reign in your hearts, because it is for this that you were called together as parts of one body. Always be thankful. Let the message of Christ, in all its richness, find a home with you. Teach each other and advise each other in all wisdom. With gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms and hymns and inspired songs to God. And never say or do anything except in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Wives, give way to your husbands, as you should in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and treat them with gentleness. Children, be obedient to your parents always, because that is what will please the Lord. Parents, never drive your children to resentment, or you will make them feel frustrated. The word of the Lord.
May the peace of Christ reign in your hearts. Let the message of Christ find a home with you.
You. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. When the day came for them to be purified as laid down by the law of Moses, the parents of Jesus took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, observing what stands written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male must be consecrated to the Lord and also to offer in sacrifice, in accordance with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves and two young pigeons. Now in Jerusalem there was a man named Simeon. He was an upright and devout man. He looked forward to Israel's comforting, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death until he had set eyes on the Christ, the Lord. Prompted by the Spirit, he came to the temple, And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the law required, he took him into his arms and blessed God and said, "Now, Master, you can let your servant go in peace, just as you promised, because my eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared for all the nations to see, a light to enlighten the pagans and the glory of your people Israel." As the child's father and mother stood there wondering at the things that were being said about him, Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "You see this child? He is destined for the fall and for the rising of many in Israel, destined to be a sign that is rejected, and a sword will pierce your own soul too, so that the secret thoughts of many may be laid bare." There was a prophetess also, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was well on in years, her days of girlhood over. She had been married for 7 years before becoming a widow. She was now 84 years old and never left the temple, serving God night and day with fasting and prayer. She came by just at that moment and began to praise God, and she spoke of the child to all who looked forward to the deliverance of Jerusalem. When everything the law required, they went back to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. Meanwhile, the child grew to maturity, and he was filled with wisdom, and God's favor was with him. The Gospel of the Lord. My dear friends in Christ, as I mentioned at the beginning of this Eucharist, today we join the whole church in celebrating the feast of the Holy Family. And I've always thought that a Holy Family, the feast that we celebrate today, comes at a very appropriate moment, just after Christmas. Because at Christmas, it gives us an opportunity to celebrate with our families, to reconnect with distant members of our families who come back at times. So it's a nice moment to recall and to give thanks to God for the gift of our own families. But more than that, our celebration today invites us to look at the Holy Family of Nazareth as a model. In fact, the feast that we celebrate today was quite recent in the church's liturgical calendar, somewhere only in the 18th century. And the importance of this Holy Family of Nazareth for us to emulate, for us to follow as an example. Even though the church invites us to follow the Holy Family of Nazareth, the irony of it all is that there's very little that is mentioned about the life of the family of Jesus in the Gospels. Very little we hear Jesus's birth at Christmas time, and today we hear about the presentation. Then we would hear a little bit later on about how Jesus going up to the temple with his parents, and he got lost and the parents found him. And that's about all. So what can we draw? What can we draw from a feast like this? And I would like to draw our attention today back to our gospel that we just heard. Jesus being presented in the temple. It is an indication that for Mary and Joseph, the life of faith was something very integral and something very important. And we know that every year to celebrate the Passover, they would go up to Jerusalem. So what it tells us, or what it calls us to, is this life of holiness that Mary and Joseph, together with Jesus, lived, is what we are called to follow. In our opening prayer this morning, we prayed that we may follow the virtues of that Holy Family of Nazareth. And what are those virtues? What are those good qualities that you and I can learn from the Holy Family of Nazareth today as we gather to celebrate the Eucharist? And I would like to look at one aspect of family life, and it centers around the word relationships. In other words, how do we grow in our relationships with one another? But before we look at that, I would like to look at the family's relationship with God as how the Holy Family of Nazareth found it important for the unity of the family. And what it tells us is that God must be at the center of our family lives. My dear friends in Christ, the reality of today's family is so different from the realities of our own family lives 20, 30 years ago. And we cannot deny that fact, how things have changed. But have things really changed in terms of our relationship with God? And I think the important part is that maybe we have let the worries of the world, we have left the occupations of the world, the preoccupations of the world, to overtake us, that our relationship with God has taken a back seat. That families barely today find time to pray together as a family. And the reality that has changed is that both parents work, and they don't work at a 9-to-5 kind of job. They come back late. And because of that new reality, families don't find time to pray together. And we see in the Holy Family of Nazareth, that was something very important. Joseph did not say to Mary and Jesus, "Mary, you stay back, look after Jesus, and I will go up to the temple." But he made that effort to take the whole family, no cars, no LRTs, no MRTs, made his way up to Jerusalem to bring his family to be able to celebrate. And this is what maybe is lacking in our own relationships with God. Very often families or parents seem to think that the realm of faith is the responsibility of the church. So they send them to Sunday school and they feel that they have fulfilled their obligations because the church will give them all the things that is required. But if you look at the church's document, it often reminds the family as the first church, as the domestic church. And that is where the relationship with God must begin to grow. Sometimes when children come to me during first communion for their first confession, I will casually ask them, you know, "Do you pray as a family at home?" And I don't know whether surprisingly or not surprisingly, many families don't pray anymore. And the reality is that these children do not even know the Our Father, the Hail Mary. And that is a sign. That is a sign that maybe God is telling us we need to take our faith life a little more seriously. That to be able to pray together, to be able to worship God together, is something that we need to look at. I often say that faith can never be taught. You can never teach someone the faith, but faith can be experienced. And faith experience begins at home. When parents pray, children begin to pray. And maybe that is what we need to look at. Firstly, our relationships with God in the way that the Holy Family of Nazareth held it important for the growth of Jesus. The second aspect of relationships that I would like to look at with you this morning, to reflect with you this morning, is the relationship with one another. How do we relate with one another in family as a unit? Today we live in a very individualized world, that each one of us, we have our own world that we live in. But how do we relate with one another? How do we talk to one another? That is something that is we need to look at ourselves. Do we find time as a family to relate with one another? not just to talk about functional things, but to talk about relational matters. Sometimes you would share with me the same experience. Sometimes, you know, families make an effort to go out for a meal together, you know, so that they want to break the monotony of eating at home, everyone eating in their rooms, in the kitchen, in the TV room. So they make an effort to go out. But you also begin to see today in restaurants, in different places, when families get together, you know, there was a time when you first thing when you go to a restaurant, you would try to get the attention of the waiter to get the menu. But today is different. You try to get the attention of the waiter or the waitress to ask for not the menu, but to ask for the Wi-Fi password first before the menu comes. And you notice that everyone is with their own little personal gadget and no one talks. And I'm sure you can relate with this. You have seen it yourself. Probably it happens in your own families too. So how do we begin to relate with one another? Technology is good, but sometimes technology isolates us from one another. That we are functional, but we stop being relational with one another. And today, the gospel ends by saying, Jesus continued to grow in maturity. Not because he had all the latest gadgets, he didn't have an iPad, a smartphone, Google or anything, but because of the family life that Joseph and Mary shared with Jesus, Jesus began to grow in maturity. And I think that's what the other aspect of relationships that we need to look at. Not just our relationships with God, but our relationships with one another. My dear friends in Christ, the most recently concluded extraordinary synod on the family that the Holy Father had called for. Many people were expecting changes, that the church must change to the new realities. And maybe what we fail to look at is that we have failed to change to the new realities. Not that the church needs to change the new realities, but we have lost maybe the fundamental relationships between God and one another in the way we build family. Many a times you get older people telling younger people, in my days, in my time, we remember the good past that we have had. How about investing time to bring back those good times? How we could relate with one another and with God. And then family life begins to be able to address these new challenges. Then we can bring the family together. And I think this is what the Holy Family of Nazareth offers us today. Not just to celebrate the birth of Jesus and the life of Jesus, but it challenges us to look at ourselves, our own family virtues or values that we prayed for this morning. So let's ask the Lord, as we continue to celebrate His birth, that we would restore, we would renew the relationships that we have. Firstly, with God, prayer. Secondly, relationships with one another. Not functional, but relational. That we get to know one another, we get to build truly a family after the Holy Family of Nazareth. So we ask the Lord for that grace this morning in our Eucharist, as we give thanks and praise to God for the gift of our families, for every member is indeed a gift of God. You know, we often say, you can choose your friends, but you cannot choose your family. It's God's gift to each. And let's learn to appreciate this great gift. We may not be perfect. The Holy Family wasn't perfect either. They had many challenges, many difficulties, and I'm sure, because though we don't read about it, they would have had their own challenges. But they tried to live what God asked of them. And despite the challenges, the imperfections that we feel, let's learn to appreciate one another. And our appreciation can turn to prayer. And prayer to God helps us to grow in relationship with Him and to grow in relationship with one another. We pray for our families this morning in our Eucharist as we offer ourselves, we ask the Lord to lead us, and may the Holy Family of Nazareth watch over us and guide us. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God, our loving Father, you gather us here this morning so that we can truly give thanks for the gift of the Holy Family of Nazareth that the Church offers us as a model. We know that there are many challenges that we encounter in living out good Catholic family lives today. But we trust in you. It is that same faith and trust that moves us to come before you now to place these our petitions. We humbly ask you to hear us.
That the Holy Father, bishops and priests, may continue to be supported and inspired by the community as they serve God and His people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That leaders of nations may respect and uphold the rights and dignity of every human being, especially those of women, children, and the aged. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all Christian parents may nurture the faith in their children as they build loving and caring families. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That families experiencing problems may lay their difficulties at the feet of Jesus and experience the power of His healing touch. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all Christian families be founded in Jesus Christ and be true witnesses to the gospel values of peace, love, and service. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all the victims of the recent floods may receive all the humanitarian aid necessary to alleviate their displacement and loss of belongings. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And we pause for a few moments. We call to mind our own intentions that we would like to offer in this Eucharist. Let us not also forget the people who have asked us to pray for them. God, our loving Father, as we place these our petitions into your loving presence, we humbly ask you to grant us the graces necessary to follow the life of the Holy Family of Nazareth. May our families experience love, peace, and joy that only comes from you. And may that peace, love, and joy be shared with one another. For we want to proclaim Jesus to be our Lord and Savior, forever and ever.
Thank you.
brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be pleasing and acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We offer you, Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation, humbly asking that, through the intercession of the Virgin Mother of God and Saint Joseph, you may establish our families firmly in your grace and your peace. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, a new light of your glory has shone upon our eyes, so that as we recognize in him God made visible, we may be caught up through him in love of things invincible. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we now acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, this bread of life, this chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us all worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Julian, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. And on this Feast of the Holy Family, we remember especially the members of our family that have returned to the Lord. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And let us now offer each other the sign of peace. Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
There will be a second collection today in all churches throughout the Archdiocese of Kuala Lumpur in aid of the flood victims, especially in the East Coast states of Peninsula Malaysia. Your generosity is greatly appreciated.
Let us pray. Lord, bring those you refresh with this heavenly sacrament to imitate constantly the example of the Holy Family of Nazareth, so that after the trials of this world, we may all share their company forever. through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please be seated for some announcements. Sunday school registration will be held on Sunday, the 4th of January, in Dewan Fatima from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. for the English section, and from 10:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. for Tamil classes. Classes will also resume on the 11th of January. There's also a need for catechists. Those who are interested in serving in this ministry are requested to contact the parish office or meet the coordinator on the 4th as well. The new washrooms have been constructed for the convenience of the parishioners, and in return, the parishioners are also requested to use them responsibly and also with due care to hygiene. The new New Year Mass schedule is also listed in the bulletin. Kindly get a copy before you leave. And finally, we would like to thank Father Clarence for celebrating Mass with us this morning, and also to wish him a Merry Christmas and a Blessed New Year.
It is always a pleasure to come back to Brickfields, or now known as KL Central, not Brickfields anymore. Wish you also a Blessed Christmas and also a joy-filled New Year. Traditionally in the church, the 28th of December is also the Feast of the Holy Innocents. And this year, since 28 falls on a Sunday, and the Sunday between Christmas and New Year is also the Feast of the Holy Family. So in this year's liturgical calendar, the Feast of the Holy Innocents is not celebrated. Nevertheless, we can always ask God to bless these children as we always do during the Feast of the Holy Innocents. So I'd like to invite the children who are gathered here to come forward. We ask God to bless you today in a very special way, and also ask this community to pray for you. No children. Let us all stand and pray for these children who are gathered here. God our Father, we place these, your children, into your loving presence. These children whom Jesus, during his public ministry, loved dearly and tenderly. We pray that they may continue to grow in their respective families, knowing your Son Jesus. May they grow in maturity, may they grow in love for your Son Jesus, that they too may become faithful disciples in the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. My dear friends, we have celebrated Jesus in this Eucharist with grateful hearts. Let us go forth to love him and to serve one another.
Thanks be to God.